Although we get tons of metrics from a force plate, there is also value in visually assessing the force time curve of a jump. So in this video, I'm going to demonstrate a variety of different force time curves from a countermovement jump to give you the confidence to assess the force time curve and understand what the different shapes and points on the curve mean. If you don't know me, I'm Jo Clubb, founder and sports science consultant at Global Performance Insights, working with teams and athletes all around the world. And I've been collaborating with Vold on this athlete testing series to illustrate some of the best practices and the science that underpins some common tests and metrics when it comes to assessing our athletes' physical capacities. In this video, we're going to be focusing on force time curves from a counter movement jump. So this is a jump that assesses the slow stretch shortening cycle. There is both an eccentric phase, so the muscles lengthening as an individual squats down, as well as the concentric phase as the individual jumps up with the muscles both contracting and shortening, as well as then the amortization phase, that brief transition from eccentric to concentric. As I previously discussed then, the countermovement jump is slightly different, of course, to a squat jump, which is just that concentric phase, as well as then a drop jump or a rebound jump that is assessing the fast stretch shortening cycle. So a stretch shortening cycle with a contact time of less than 250 milliseconds. But a countermovement jump, we see a longer contraction time. So here we have an illustration of a countermovement jump force time curve. And this infographic comes courtesy of Vold, who have kindly sponsored not just this video, but all the videos in our athlete testing series, talking about a whole range of different technologies, tests, and metrics. I'll put a link below to that playlist so you can check out all the other videos as well in this series. Here then we can see some of the key landmarks of the jump alongside the force time curve itself. Now, because Vold's force dex is a bilateral force plate, we get these separate outputs from the left and right sides, represented here in the orange and blue series, as well as then the cumulative force time curve, each shown here in gray. You can see the jump is simply split here into that eccentric phase where the individual is squatting down, the concentric phase where they are jumping upwards, the flight phase where they are actually have taken off and are in the air, and then the landing phase. But we're actually going to dive a little bit deeper than this today. So here again, courtesy of Vold, is a more detailed breakdown of the different phases of this force time curve in a countermovement jump. We can see that crucially, we start with this quiet phase where the individual is nice and still on the force plate. And the force that is registered at this point is the equivalent of just their body weight shown in newtons. Here then we have the entire eccentric phase as it relates to the downward phase of the countermovement jump. And initially we have our unloading phase. So this is represents the start of the movement. It's when an individual starts to lower themselves down by flexing at the hip, the knee and the ankle, and therefore essentially unweights themselves from that force plate. At the bottom of that unloading phase, then we switch to the braking phase of the eccentric phase of the jump. Here they are still squatting downwards, but they are applying more and more force into the force plates. And we can see the point at which the force then surpasses what is the equivalent of their body weight. You can see here in the orange point upwards, that is still breaking east within the eccentric phase, but that point is specifically the deceleration phase within the braking phase within the eccentric phase. That is the point at which the eccentric force that they are putting into the plate is greater than just their body weight, and it's from that point upwards to the very bottom point of their squat. At that lowest point in terms of their squat within the jump, we then switch to the concentric phase, which is the upward phase then of takeoff. we can see here that Vold break this into phase one and phase two. Those represent the first 50% in terms of time of the concentric phase for P1 and the second 50% in terms of time for P2. We can think about P1 relating more to that initial propulsion phase at the lowest point of their squat, as opposed to P2, which is the second half of that upward phase, relating more then to that triple extension. More and more research is exploring the relevance of these different phases, and there is some research showing significant differences between ACL rehab athletes compared to healthy controls in the concentric impulse asymmetry in that P2 phase. So we're going to take a closer look of this trace with some real countermovement jump examples. And there are a few things that I'm looking for when I'm looking at the raw force time curve. First of all, I check that quiet standing phase to make sure the individual is nice and still, as a way of doing a quick data quality check, because it's so important that they're nice and still, and then initiate the movement so we get a clear understanding in the calculations to use for their body mass, as well as the correct time at which the movement started. I'm looking visually as well at the symmetry or the asymmetry between the left and the right curve. And then I'm coming to kind of the shape, really, of that takeoff phase of the jump. And as you'll see, I'm looking at the length of time, so therefore the speed of the takeoff phase. I'm looking at the magnitude of the force, and those together then, the time and the magnitude, give us this idea around the shape of the curve. So let's bring this to life now with some real examples. Here then we have an example of a force trace from the Vold Hub based on data collected by their ForceDex force plate technologies. And this is an example of a data validation check, because here, unfortunately, we don't have a nice quiet standing phase. You can see this wobble here in the green line, a bit of loading, unloading, even more loading before the actual unloading phase. So there we don't get neither a accurate calculation of the individual's body mass, nor a clear point at which the movement started. We can see clearly the individual's kind of bouncing back and forth between their left and right side. And that continues here into this second rep, where they are fidgeting around, and therefore we're getting this bumpy force time curve. So I would actually completely remove these trials and have the individual jump again and really cue them to stay nice and still. So here we have another example, a much better quiet standing phase here. And we've zoomed in here on one individual trial. You can see that this one is selected. So one thing we definitely need to be aware of when looking at these force time curves is that these axes can be dynamic based on the data collected in the specific trials. So we have to be cognizant of the size of the axes when we are zooming in on this level. Now, what I'm seeing with this individual, of first and foremost, is quite a clear asymmetry here throughout the whole of the takeoff. You can see the orange line, so the right-sided force production is much greater. I'm sure that would show up as well, of course, in our metric outputs, but it's interesting to see it here visually, both on takeoff and on landing, much more force being put through that right-hand side. In terms of the shape of the curve itself, this is not a very steep curve. It is quite a prolonged jump. We can see actually in the data as well that there was about 900 milliseconds in terms of the contraction time. So it's a very slow build up, not a very steep takeoff curve for this individual. And unsurprisingly, that results in a poor flight time contraction ratio or RSI mod, whichever one is your preference. And so this is really an example of that slower, drawn out takeoff phase. We have a similar story with this jump. Again, the contraction time here is about 700 milliseconds. So again, that's pretty slow in terms of the takeoff phase. We can see it's not a nice steep curve here, And also we can see asymmetry, this time leaning more into that left-hand side. And so the blue line is showing greater, again, both on takeoff and on landing. Let's contrast those last two examples then with this one. We see a much steeper curve for the takeoff due to really a faster contraction time. We see it's nice and smooth and relatively symmetrical throughout as well. You may have also have noticed that there was a difference in the shape. So not just in terms of being steep, but here we have a single curve, whereas here we've got a bit of a bumpy curve. This kind of a jump is classed as a unimodal jump. That's where there's this single bump, if you like, on the force time curve. And that is in contrast to a bimodal jump, where we have these two bumps in our takeoff. And so you might notice this video is part one. In part two, we're going to dive even deeper into the detail of unimodal and bimodal force time curve shape. I hope this video has given you the confidence to go away and look into the actual visual force time curve from the countermovement jump with your athletes, and to pair that with then the metrics that the system is spitting out. If you enjoyed this video, please like and subscribe, and make sure you come back to watch that part two video in which I dive deeper into the shape of the force time curve in even more detail.